Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back to my channel. Welcome back to this series of videos on abiogenesis and evolution. So in the last video, I introduced myself and tried to be honest and open about my biases. I do my best to practice what I preach, leave my ego at the door, and to be as balanced as I possibly can. Now, as I said before, I'm by no means an expert in this area. There are so many sub-disciplines in both the fields of origin of life research and evolution. And of course, these are typically materialistic domains, areas of research which begin with the assumption that there is no creator. Everything happened from nothing, basically. There are essentially two camps, as I mentioned in the last video. There are those that believe that life came from nothing, the universe originated from nothing, and from that nothing, something came, and then abiogenesis happened, which we'll define in a second, and then evolution took place, and then here we are. That's basically, you know, the majority of the scientific community. So you either believe in that or you don't. Those are kind of the two basic fields. So let's break it down a little bit. There are basically three kind of fundamental aspects of the materialistic belief system that pertain to the origin of the universe, the origin of life, and then how life developed. So for the first one, the origin of the universe, I think it's pretty safe to say that what Lawrence Krauss has popularized, which is not an original idea, he took it from, developed it from others, is that the universe came from nothing. Now, if you, I've done a video on this, and if you look into what he's saying, he's manipulating a lot. He's manipulating the definition of nothing and trying to use complex words and theories to confuse people. And what it seemed to rest on for me is the whole idea of virtual particles. Virtual particles are a kind of a mathematical side effect that come from using Feynman diagrams. They're part of the maths, or math if you're from America, that has to be used in order to calculate what you calculate with Feynman diagrams. So then Krauss postulated that because, you know, you have to use these virtual particles, that they must exist, and therefore things can pop in and out of existence as they want. The second one is the origin of life. Materialists talk about abiogenesis and the theories surrounding abiogenesis, which is basically life arising from non-living matter. That's pretty much the definition of abiogenesis. So we're going to talk about this aspect today. And the third part is, of course, what happened after life appeared, according to the materialistic model, which is, single-celled organisms or something along those lines, or slime or protoplasm. What happened after that? Well, evolution happened after that, according to them. Which evolution, of course, we'll talk about that later, but that's the concept that random mutations, and so I've come across some materialists that don't like to say random, but it's basically random things that happen. There's no target, there's nobody controlling it, there's nothing controlling it, it just happens. Mutations, and then once the organism has to be living, natural selection supposedly takes place. And this is where we break it into microevolution and macroevolution, and we'll talk about that later, inshallah. But today I really wanted to talk about abiogenesis. But it's important to remember, why am I talking about this? Because there's a lot of research that I've done into this. I've put a lot of time and effort into this, and I've still only scratched the surface. And it's quite a confusing area because there's so many different disciplines and so many different people doing research. And I just wanted to share with people what I've learned so that, you know, you don't have to put in the same amount of effort. But at the same time, putting in the effort is not a bad thing. It's worth doing, and you do learn a lot. And of course, as Muslims, we believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah the Most High, created everything that exists between the heavens and the earth. He's always been, he's ever living, Azza wa Jal. And we believe in the Quran and the prophethood of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah's peace and blessings be upon him. So this is where I'm coming from once again, just to be open with everyone. So on my side, I believe there was a creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and on the materialistic side, they believe there was no creator, and all of the stuff that happened is just purely by luck. Nothing was intervening, it's just stuff that happened. So abiogenesis, what is it? As I said before, it's the concept that life arises from non-living matter. So I'll start where most people start, and that's with a man called Alexander Oparin. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. He set out an origin of life scenario around about 1936. Now what he said was that the gases and compounds that existed on the early Earth, what some call the prebiotic Earth, interacted in a particular way with ammonia and lightning and heat and whatever was present and happening at that time at the early Earth. So a lot of assumptions there on, you know, what gases, compounds, etc. would have been present to, and how they would have interacted. And through that interaction, amino acids emerged. And as we know, amino acids are the fundamental building blocks of proteins. So that was the first part of Oparin's theory. The second part was that things called coacervates, which are formed from lipids, and lipids have a sort of one side, which is what they call attracts water, on one side, which repels water. So they form these kind of spheres, which he theoreticized would allow the amino acids within and proteins, because he felt that the amino acids would join together and form proteins, and that these coacervates, as he called them, would protect the proteins and amino acids, which could then interact with each other inside this safe little shell. He then believed that, following on from this and millions of years in time and interaction, that basic cells would emerge from this, and then natural selection and all that kind of stuff would take place, and there you go, that's how it happened. Then in 1952, a very famous experiment called the Miller-Urey experiment was carried out. I'm going to read here. Using boiling water, Miller circulated a gaseous mixture of methane, ammonia, water, and hydrogen through a glass apparatus containing a spark chamber to simulate lightning. After 2 days, he found amino acids, and those amino acids were glycine, alpha-alamine, and beta-alanine. Apologies for my poor pronunciation. So that was a kind of a validation of Oparin's theory. And you can imagine, things went crazy. People, you know, they had the Darwinian theory, and now we've created amino acids from what we believe were the initial conditions on an early Earth, or the conditions on an early Earth. And, you know, we've got 3 or 4 amino acids. And I think they opened recently the experimental jars that were sealed back then, and they found even more amino acids in there. But following on from the discovery of Watson and Crick of the structure of the double helix, of the DNA, this kind of threw the materialist camp into disarray again. A lot more questions came up. So always remind you of this phrase, as we say in English, the devil is in the details. Don't be scared to ask the details. When someone comes to you and says something, like, I saw a video the other week, again, started off with a lot of making fun of people that believed in intelligent design, as it's been called. And then they moved on to try to explain other things, again, using words like mutation, natural selection, just strewn in there to cover over chasms that were unexplainable, as far as I could see. And they started even bringing in new terms like coevolution and things like this. And the guy in the video that I was watching, I remember him saying, if you remember anything about this video, remember this term, coevolution. And I was thinking, okay, fine, I'll remember coevolution, but what exactly? There was no detail, there was no meat, there was no sequence of chemically, this is what happened. It's just a story. If I go into a kitchen and get some eggs and flour and some water, some icing, whatever else it is you need to make a cake, and I just leave them in the kitchen, I've got all the raw materials there that I need to make the cake. I've got the oven, I've got gas connected to the oven. But without the actual chef, that cake's not going to come together. Now, if I'm going to explain to you how I make that cake, I need to say, I take the egg and I crack the egg on the side. Inside the egg, you have the contents. The contents are going to come out. They're going to go into the bowl. I then take this tool and I whisk the egg. I take a pinch of salt with my fingers like this. I'm explaining to you exactly how those components came together. But you don't find that. You just say, through a process of cooking, the cake was made. And the thing with proteins, the more I learn about how the cell works, the complexity of the cell, how DNA codes for proteins, how the proteins are manufactured by effectively micro machines inside, billions of micro machines inside the cells in your body. It's a construction factory. It's not something that you can say happened by chance. I mean, you can try to convince me that these things happen by chance by using sarcasm and, you know, talking about fairies in the sky or whatever it is. But at the end of the day, I know what I can see with my own eyes. So ultimately the issue is, and I know that materialists hate this, but there is an information problem. Where did the information come from? And yes, I've read a lot of books by Dr. Stephen Myers, by Michael Behe and these kind of people. But they go through the steps. They use what I consider to be a scientific method, a scientific approach. So yeah, the information problem. Where did the information come from? Not going to call it a language. I'm going to call it a code, because it is a code. DNA actually contains code. It contains instructions on how to manufacture proteins. These proteins aren't trivial, you know, simple things to make. They're extremely complicated. Refer to an amazing film I saw the other day on CRISPR, which is the new discovery they've made about how to do gene editing. And CRISPR is basically the Cas9 protein, which is part of nature, if you like, anyway. It was something that was discovered that already exists, and they're just figuring out how to use it. And they spoke about sickle cell anemia and the fact that it's just one letter on the genome that's in the wrong position. And it causes the protein for hemoglobin, if I'm not mistaken, to be manufactured incorrectly. It doesn't form the correct shape just because of one letter in the genetic code. And as a result of that, the red blood cell becomes extremely stiff, and you know, oxygen can't access the parts of the body it needs to access, and it's a nasty disease. But then you have some people that carry the sickle cell trait who are immune to malaria, for example. It's really incredible to watch and listen to these scientists speak and the discoveries they've made, and to realize that basically everything they're doing is off the substrate of what exists already in nature. Even when we create our, it's apparently very easy for us to manufacture RNA, but we manufacture RNA using the building blocks we take from nature. For us to actually manufacture those building blocks, as far as I understand from scientists, is nigh on impossible. So again, back to abiogenesis, you had the operin theory, then Miliuri did the experiment, then you have people talking about, well, maybe proteins came first, maybe DNA came first, and several other theories. But what we seem to have settled on in the materialist camp is what they call RNA world, which is that RNA came first, and then subsequently DNA came along. This was originally proposed by, and I'm going to need to read this, by Carl Woese, or Woese, a microbiologist, in the mid-1980s. He stated that RNA sequences can serve as biological catalysts and even self-replicate. And many Origin of Life researchers don't like this RNA world. It still suffers from the information problem and a number of other problems too. Now, this video is getting a bit long. I don't want it to be boring for anyone. One thing I read in a book the other day was a reflection on Richard Lenski's experiments with E. coli, which is one of the largest evolution experiments ever carried out. If you want more details on this, Michael Behe does an excellent discussion of it in one of his books. And that is that when we talk about evolution, we talk about an increase in complexity from basic ingredients, basic operational systems. But what we tend to see in nature is a decrease in complexity. And that's what we saw in Richard Lenski's experiment with E. coli, that these bacteria were jettisoning parts of their gene structure that were not being used and were unnecessary. So the tendency is actually towards simplification rather than towards complexity. Very, very interesting area. So anyway, that's a quick summary of abiogenesis. This video is a kind of a start taster on abiogenesis. And in the next video, inshallah, I'll be talking about evolution. So just before we go, what I think I'll do in the next video is I'll make a much shorter video. But I'm going to do it on something called chirality. And chirality is basically, the meaning of chirality is basically handedness. So if something has, you know, a left hand or a right hand, it's a property. So my left hand has left-handed chirality, my right hand has right-handed chirality. And this is something which is of extreme significance in origin of life, and it's a big issue, which I've had a look around as much as I could, and I couldn't find anything more than a couple of papers. And again, the people that support the materialistic view of origin of life really skim over these details and try to kind of, you know, we don't want to talk about that. So I'll do a short video on that next. Inshallah, you'll find that really interesting because I'm absolutely fascinated by it. Anyway, I hope this was useful for you. I hope the audio is a little bit better this time. I really tried to set it up, and would love to hear your comments on this content. And see you next time, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.